Blackstone Publishing presents The Return of Vaman, a scientific novel by Jayant V. Narlikar. This book is read by Neil Shah. Preface. It gives me great pleasure to present this sample of my science fiction work to the international reader. So far, my sci-fi stories and novels have only been published within India, where they have received a warm welcome. However, this happens to be the first occasion when a novel and a short story are being jointly published by Springer. Since this is the first time my science fiction is being projected abroad, the publisher made the very pertinent suggestion that I also write an introductory article describing my association with this form of literature. It is all the more pertinent because by profession, I am a scientist working in the field of astrophysics. This exercise includes a brief description of my background and why and how I got into writing sci-fi. Knowing full well that other sci-fi writers may have different viewpoints, I felt that I should stick to my own views in a personalized, autobiographical statement. Life in India is inextricably mixed with Indian mythology, and this shows up in the two examples of sci-fi presented here. This is peculiar to India, and one may wonder how ancient myths can be combined with futuristic ideas that arise in sci-fi. Thus, Ganesha and Vaman are part of those myths, but, through various rituals, they have become part of our modern world of jets, computers, and cell phones. So why not take a step into the future and integrate them into science fiction? Anyway, since my views in extenso are given in my introductory article, I will be brief here. It only remains for me to thank the Springer publication staff, and in particular, Chris Karen, for a very helpful interaction. Their help and advice are much appreciated. Jayant V. Narlikar, Inter-University Center for Astronomy and Astrophysics, Pune, India, January 2015. Part 1. A Short Story. Ganesha, 1975. The Rare Idol of Ganesha. As I stepped off the bus outside the Oval, I had a premonition that I was going to witness something unusual. Today, looking back after the events, I see no reason to account for that premonition. But then, aren't premonitions, by definition, unaccountable? So far as I can see, the only thing unusual was that I had found time to watch a test match live, and this was fully accountable. As I presented my complimentary pass at the gate, I fingered the note which accompanied it. 14th August 2005. Dear John, I sincerely request you to watch my performance in what is going to be my final test appearance. Hope you can make it. Regards. Sincerely yours, Pramod Rangnekar. Pramod and I were Cambridge Blues in the team which won the varsity match in 89. Later, Pramod became a professional, rising to great heights as his performances against the West Indies, Australia, and the MCC have testified. I, regrettably, gave up cricket altogether. Such were the demands of my work as an Indologist, and now as a museum curator. Indeed, it came as a shock to me that I was visiting a cricket ground after 15 years. Today was the second day's play, and I had chosen this day because India was going to field, and I would be able to watch Pramod in action. Yesterday, on a perfect wicket in bright sunshine, India was expected to amass a huge score. However, the Indian batsmen did not fulfill these expectations, and England was left to face a relatively modest first-inning score of 308. The second day's play began quietly, with no hint of what was to come. In 1 hour, the England openers Willis and Jones put up a score of 40 for no loss. After the drinks, the Indian captain Bhandari called in Rangnekar to bowl, and the unusual chain of events was set in motion. Pramod was greeted with great applause, which had an element of sympathy about it, for, as all followers of the game knew, this was his last test. Indeed, during this series, his performance had been indifferent. The old fire and magic had gone from his bowling, which could now be easily read by the England batsmen. There had been an increasing demand that Pramod be dropped from the team. Nevertheless, the selectors once again plumped for experience rather than quality and gave him this last chance. Would he live up to their expectations? The first hint of the unusual came when Pramod prepared to bowl.
Right arm over the wicket?
Asked umpire Coates, who was familiar with his style of bowling.
No, said Pramod, to the umpire's surprise. Left arm over the wicket.
Pramod had never bowled with his left arm. Even Bhandari was puzzled and wanted to discourage Pramod. However, Pramod persisted.
Okay, I will allow the old one over this nonsense,
muttered Bhandari to himself. By now, the commentators on radio and TV had learnt of Pramod's intention and had started commenting on it. How could a right-handed bowler suddenly decide to bowl left-handed? And that too in a test match when his side badly needed a wicket. This was against all precedents. But then everything that followed was going to be against any precedent. With his first ball, which was remarkably accurate, Pramod knocked off opener Willis's leg stump. As a confounded Willis made his way back to the pavilion, he warned the new batsman,
"Take care, the joker's sent down a funny one to me."
The warning was to be of no avail. Pramod's left-handed bowling was completely unexpected, and neither number three nor any of his successors could make any sense of it. From 40 for no wicket, England was bundled out for a total of a mere 78 runs. As I munched my sandwich during the lunch interval, I pondered over the remarkable transformation which had come over the game in such a short time, a transformation which perhaps distinguishes cricket from any other game. Would England recover in the second innings as they followed on 230 runs behind? The old gentleman sitting next to me wondered moodily whether Rangnekar would overtake Jim Laker's record of 19 wickets.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.